Well, it's been a long time, and I apologize for that. I've been gone for maybe like a month, 2 months now. I really apologize about that. It's not my fault. It was that dog. The dog was barking everywhere. And also, I wanted to apologize for saying that the three Scooby-Doo movies, the three animated movies, I wanted to apologize for saying that they was terrible, but I was gonna review them in maybe like a second. Yeah, this is Derrick Yasha, and today I'm going to review Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island and more. Hell, too, the fucking yeah, dog. So let's get into it. The story and what the movie is about. All right. So, anyways, what happened was after they catch the molt monster, Daphne is telling a backstory on this like this interview show, and of course that she has the show called Coast to Coast with Daphne Blake. It's sort of a Ghost Hunters ripoff. But anyways, Fred works with her, and you get the gist that they went their own separate ways. Shaggy and Scooby work at an airport. They are contraband finders. Of course, that Velma works in a bookstore or a library. And Fred comes up with this great idea to bring the gang back. And also, he surprises Daphne, and of course, that they're trying to find real hauntings, but they can't because it's people in masks yet again. And of course, Daphne is sick and tired of this shit. And of course, we get the new character, Lena. Now, Lena, of course, tells them about this island that has hauntings on it, this and that, whatever. So, anyways, they go there, and thus the fact that you have a little bit of a haunting there, and of course, spoiler alert, zombies come to life. Of course, you have the living dead on this island. And I don't want to spoil it, but I will give spoilers later. All right, but anyways, I'm gonna have to say, the story is really good here, as this is a really dark and, I mean, just serious toned Scooby-Doo movie. This is the first Scooby-Doo movie to ever be dark like this, actually. And I'm just gonna have to say it's really good storytelling. Okay, so let's get on to the voice acting. Of course, everyone does a very good job. Also, you got Adrienne Barbeau as Miss Lemoine, and of course, you got Jim Cummings as Jacques. And I forgot this voice actor's name, but he did the voice for Liquid Snake in Metal Gear. Yeah, he does the voice for the gardener in this movie. And also, the gardener is a detective. Yeah, so, anyways, just getting back to it, the voice acting is really good. The writing, I gotta say, the writing is really excellent. As we thought that this was just gonna be another, oh, it's just gonna be a guy in a mask or something. But no, the monsters in this movie, when they get on the island, is actually real. And that's really awesome. That's really badass. Really, that's really fucking awesome. And anyways, just really good writing. Dialogue is good in this movie. The animation is excellent. And this is really good animation for 1998. I mean, my God, this is just phenomenal. The cinematography and the visuals look really good for an animated movie, to believe it or not. The original scores is good, and also you got two really good songs in here. The Ghost is here, and It's Terror Time Again. Hell, too, the fucking Yeah Dog. And those are my two favorite songs out of this movie. I'm sorry. It's been a long time since I ever did this. But getting back to it, overall, the movie itself. Overall, this is an entertaining movie, and whatever you do, if you are going to watch this with the kiddies, yes, this is a really dark Scooby-Doo movie. And it doesn't get dark until they get onto the island. So if your kids really get scared easily, just shut this off. But anyways, the movie gets a 5 out of 5. And it gets a hell fucking yeah dog, and yeah, check this movie out, but I'm gonna give some spoilers away. Yeah, of course that the ghost that's haunting the house is, of course, Morgan Moonscar. And what happened was Simone and Lena had to basically give their souls to turn into these werecats. Yeah, how awesome is that, dude? Really. And I love werecats. I mean, there was a werecat in Michael Jackson's Thriller. Michael turned into a werecat. There was werecats in Sleepwalkers. Yeah, so there's a lot of homages to Thriller and Sleepwalkers. Hell, too, the fucking Yeah Dog. So anyways, yeah, Simone and Lena was behind the whole thing, those stupid bitches for tormenting those souls. Yeah, so actually the zombies are the good guys in the film. And you don't know it until like almost near the end of the film when they're trying to help the gang out and trying to help everyone out from Lena, Simone, and Jacques. Yeah, and Jacques turns into an ultimate badass werecat. Yeah, that's really awesome and terrifying at the same time. Me, my God. But anyways, that's enough spoilers because I don't really want to give this whole movie away, and I'm sorry that I did. I really am. I really am. But let's get on to the next movie. Okay, and that, of course, is, I guess, my second favorite out of these Scooby-Doo movies where actual events happen. And that, of course, is Scooby-Doo and the Witch's Ghost. So where do I begin off? The story and what the movie is about. I'm gonna have to admit, we had a generic beginning. Nothing really rememberable there. What? These Viking guys chasing them down in the museum, and then it's just like a generic episode of Scooby-Doo. But then things get a little bit better off after that. We get introduced to Ben Ravencroft, and of course Ben Ravencroft believes that he is a warlock, and of course that his ancestor is Sarah Ravencroft. And of course that Sarah Ravencroft would I guess heal people and aid people. So yeah, but also that there's a twist, but I won't tell you that until later on. Anyways, they gotta go to this town and figure out this mystery. Of course that at first, yes, people was behind the witch's ghost, and then later into the film, we find out that Ben Ravencroft was trying to get the key to this book so that he could basically summon Sarah Ravencroft back to, I guess, this time or whatever. So yeah, anyways, the story is really good. Thus the fact after the start happens. So yeah, I'm sorry, my computer's freaking out. Let me see. Okay, so let me continue on. Yeah, the story is really good here. All right, the voice acting by everyone, including Tim Curry. Tim Curry does a phenomenal job as Ben Ravencroft. I mean, thumbs up to the guy, really. Really. He anything the guy does, he's phenomenal in. Really, just really good voice acting by everyone, including Tim. And the writing is excellent for this movie. And then the twist that you get in this movie, but Sarah's only on for like 10 or 15 minutes, and that's it, basically. Yeah. And the characters, because I forgot to mention that. Of course, that you have this band called the Hex Girls, and if you don't know, the Hex Girls is my favorite. Yeah, they make really good music, believe me. Yeah, and I like Thorn slash Sally. Yeah, I find her attractive, so what? But anyways, getting back into it. Okay, so the dialogue was good in this movie. The animation is really good for. I don't know when this movie was out, maybe 1999 or 2000. If I'm right, maybe 1999. I believe this movie came out a year later after Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island. But anyways, yeah. I think I already said it, but I'll say it again. The cinematography and the visuals was really good. The music, the original scores, and the two Hex Girl songs was really nice. And overall, the movie itself, I'm gonna have to say, this is a step down from like Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island because, hey, at least half of it was real zombies, real ghosts, and real werepanthers or werecats, whatever. Whereas in this, yeah, it was people behind the whole thing, but then sorta you get Ben Ravencroft bringing Sarah back, basically. But yeah, the movie gets a 4 out of 5. It was good. It was not great, like this movie. But yeah, a little bit of spoilers. Yeah. So anyways, the funniest thing I found hilarious about this movie is. How much Scooby and Shaggy eat in this movie, man? Seriously, I mean, when they're in that restaurant, and they're just ordering the whole foods, man, the whole menu. My God, I'm gonna have to say that's one of my favorite parts of this movie because really. Nah, but my favorite part of the movie was when Sarah comes back. Second favorite part was the Hex Girls. I'm not going to lie. And I really liked it when they got on the screen, man. No lie and no pun intended, dude, honestly. But yeah, I'm just gonna have to say I just wanted to spoil this movie a little bit, not that much, because I want you guys to watch this for real. Okay, so the next one and the final one is Scooby-Doo and the Cyber Chase. Well, anyways, what the movie is about in the story. So let's get into it. All right. So, of course, that they gotta solve this mystery of the Phantom Virus. And basically what happens is they get sucked into this video game world. And I mean, the story was okay here, but like the last 10 or 15 minutes of this movie is really good. Or whatever it was, the last 30 minutes. Yeah, because you get they go into this alternate world of them, basically. And basically, you meet alternate Scooby and alternate Shaggy, alternate Fred, alternate Daphne, whatever. Yeah, that was really good. And also that the only time that the monsters was real was in that video game universe, anyways. Some of it was just like it took place in like the Mythos times and medieval times and the Greek era and whatever the hell. Okay? So yeah, the story is just a mix mash, honestly. Let's get into the voice acting. The voice acting was okay here, but I thought they could have done a little bit better. Come on. I mean, from these two movies, Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island and Scooby-Doo and the Witch's Ghost, come on, dude. They could have did a fucking better job, honestly, with this. Because the voice acting, sometimes it's okay, sometimes it's just like and then sometimes it's back on. Yeah, that's how it is. The characters are not really interesting in this movie, although the characters was interesting in Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island. Of course, that was the new characters. And the new characters in this was a little bit interesting, not that much. But over here, you just have a generic old professor guy, you have a generic guard, you have a generic guy that's into baseball, and of course, trying to make a baseball game prototype. And of course, you have the tech nerd that's trying to make the average video game. Yeah, that's about it. That's the only thing you get for characters, honestly. And the only thing that's rememberable is the Phantom Virus, honestly. That's the only thing that's rememberable. Okay, so the writing, I thought they could have did a little bit better with the writing. And of course, oh, let's just throw them in a video game universe. That was thrown in at the last minute. Come on, people, honestly, because they were like, okay, we already did zombies and ghosts and werecats. We already did witches or one witch. So why don't we just do something with games and let's do something with a virus? Yeah, which although yes, as a kid or as I guess a 12-year-old or a 13-year-old, yeah, I used to praise the fucking shit out of this movie. I mean, come on, dude, it's okay, it's all right, honestly. But I'll stop talking about the writing dialogue. The dialogue was sometimes good and hideous at the same times. And it was just shocking what sometimes characters would slur out of their mouths and yada yada whatever. Okay. So yeah, the cinematography and the visuals was okay. The animation was a little bit cheap. I'm just gonna have to say it was really cheap. Honestly, from these two, yeah, the animation was really good in these two films, but the animation just suffers, as it looks like it was going into what's new Scooby-Doo, and I guess that was a part of that, I guess so. But yeah, let me get back to it. The music is not memorable except for the one scene where it's a montage or something, where they're running from the monsters or some bullshit like that. Yeah. Yeah, that music was really good, and I'll try to do it. Yeah, that was the only good score out of the whole movie. That was it, because excuse me, sorry. But yeah, that was the only good score, because everything else would suffer, honestly. And overall, the movie itself, this is a decent time waster. Yeah, it's enjoyable for the last 30 minutes. I would say put this on for the last 30 minutes and that's it. Because other than that, what you are going to get is a mishmash of a What's New Scooby-Doo kind of feel to it. And also a generic feel to it with those characters that I mentioned. You could rewind the video back a little bit. The old professor guy, the generic guard, the generic baseball fanatic, and the generic tech nerd. Yeah. So, I'm gonna give this movie a 3 out of 5. Honestly, it was just mediocre at best, but for the last 30 minutes, I mean, kinda did get a 5 out of 5 just for that last 30 minutes, but no. This actually gets a 3 out of 5. I'm sorry, people. I apologize. And I'm just showing the backs, too, so yeah. I mean, if you want my honest opinion, it's already spoiled because the Phantom Virus is into baseball, and it's already explained who it is, and it's the baseball fanatic. Enough said, honestly. So not only that, you're gonna figure this out soon as you see the Phantom Virus making baseball hints. So, yeah, there's no mystery there. So, yeah. That was not a spoiler either, because when you watch the movie, you'll see it for yourself. My final thoughts. I recommend Scooby-Doo on Zombie Island. I recommend Scooby-Doo and the Witch's Ghost. And I kind of recommend Scooby-Doo and Cyber Chase, even though it has that Scooby-Doo, what new Scooby-Doo feel to it. I'm sorry, people. But, yeah. Other than that, I'd say if you want to, marathon these before Halloween. That's what I did. Actually, to believe it or not, I watched Scooby-Doo on October 1st. So, yeah. How awesome is that, dude? I'm sorry if this was an epic fail video. I tried my very best. And anyways, 25 minute mark, and I am out. Peace.